Good morning, everybody. Good to see you here. We're in the presence of who? God. His son's name is? Jesus. Good, you're just a little slow. Did you not have your coffee? Working on it. Okay. Welcome. If you're online with us, glad you're joining us to worship Jesus. I want to bring us into worship with Psalm 92. So I'm going to ask you to repeat it after me. It is good to praise the Lord, to make music to your name, O Most High, to proclaim your love in the morning, and your faithfulness at night, to the music of the six-string guitar, actually says 10-string lyre, but we don't have one of those. And the melody of the harp. We don't have that either. And I'll just read this for you. For you make me glad by your deeds, O Lord. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. How great are your works. Why is it good to sing praise to God in the morning? It says, good to praise the Lord, to make music to your name. Why is that good? Well, we're here to do that. But why is it good? It changes your heart, brings your heart into happiness and joy. Are there any other reasons why it's good to sing God's praises? Focus on him. Say? Focus on him. We focus on him. And why is it good to focus on him? Serve him. Well, we want to serve him. But why is it good to serve God? He's worthy of it. Well, there's a reason. He's worthy of it. Does it do anything to us? It builds our faith, yeah? Lifts your spirit, and it changes us. When you worship God, it changes us too, right? So, all right, here's what we're going to do. We're going to praise God in the morning. We're going to sing worship songs to him. While we're doing that, you see the four charts on the side of the wall? This is our series of The Art of Neighboring, right? At the beginning of the series, you wrote on the wall the names of people who live around your house, right? And our challenge was to become better neighbors and to find out about more people and meet more of our neighbors, okay? So if you met anybody or got to know another one of your neighbors, I want you to go to the chart during the opening set of songs. We're going to sing three songs. You can go anytime you want. The pens are all red or pink or orange or something like that. They're no black because we want to be able to see if we met anybody. Did anybody meet anybody in their neighborhood? Anybody at all? Okay, all right, that's a start. So go ahead and put it on the chart sometime while we're singing, all right? Let's praise God. Why don't you stand up? Like thunder every day.
every king and every ruler, throwing down their crowns at your feet. All majesty and power on the earth and above, be to the only God who was and is. Majesty, he is alive. In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. That stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe. For the souls of all could come to the Father are restored. And the Church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise the Father.
Son's name. Amen. Could you please be seated? All right, we're going to have the kids come up front. Now, I know you guys go to children's worship after this, but does anybody know what we've been talking about the last few weeks? That's okay. Neighbors. Neighbors. Can you say neighbors?
Neighbor.
Yeah. She said she hasn't been here the last few weeks. We've been talking about our neighbors and how we can get to know them better, how we can share our time with them and show Jesus' love to them. So we're going to keep talking about neighbors, but this is going to be kind of a different way of talking about them. How many of you have gone camping? Anybody gone camping? Anybody gone hiking? Surely you've gone hiking. Okay. I know you guys have gone camping. So do your parents ever carry around a backpack when you go hiking? Sometimes. And what might there be in there? Maybe some extra clothes in case you get wet. Maybe some dry socks if your feet get wet. Those don't feel very good. A flashlight in case you get lost in the dark. And maybe some snacks and water because you get hungry. Yeah? Okay. So we pack our backpacks with the things that we need, right? These are kind of just our particular load. And who carries a backpack to school? There we go. Now we got it. And we've got books in there, and those are our personal books and our homework and maybe our water bottles and our snacks for the day. So I'm going to have Grayson and Skye come up here and help me for a second because I brought their backpacks. So Skye, you put on your backpack because that's your load, all right? And Grayson, you put yours on. Okay. Now, if you go camping, or even if you have a big group hiking, you might bring something like this along. What's this? A cooler. All right, and what would we put in our cooler? Water. Maybe, I like lunch meat sandwiches, so we're gonna have lunch meat and cheese and bread and mustard and mayonnaise, and we can't have lunch without cookies and chips, right? So. Grayson, why don't you come over and I want you to carry the cooler. Well, it doesn't have wheels. You got to pick the whole thing up. Can you do that? You're going to carry the food for all of us today. How's that? Can you do that? That's pretty hard. What else should we try instead? Oh, maybe both people could do it. There's two handles, right? And there's two people. So, Skye, come over here. See if you can pick it up and carry it. There you go. Oh, that's a lot easier. That makes more sense. So, we have our own materials and our own loads in our backpacks. And we're responsible for those things, like our homework at school and our chores at home. Those are our responsibility. But then, you know what? Sometimes we carry extra burdens. And that's where we can come alongside our friends and our neighbors, and we can help them carry them. Because everybody has their own responsibilities that they have to take care of, but sometimes there's things that are extra, and we can step alongside our friends and our neighbors, and we can help them carry it, because it's just a lot easier when we share that burden together. All right, so you guys can have a seat, and let's pray about how we can distinguish the difference between our loads and our burdens, okay? Lord Jesus, I thank you so much for these children here today, and I thank you that we have responsibilities. We have chores, we have our own homework, and we have things that help us learn and grow, and that we get to learn and grow in you, Lord. But God, we also recognize that there are just some extra care loads, extra burdens that we and our friends and our neighbors might carry. And I ask you to help us to recognize that and help us to see when we can step in and help those around us. I pray that you bless our time here today. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so you guys can head off to children's worship or back to your seats, okay?
No cookies. Now let's talk to God together. Lord God, we love you because you're the God that never gives up. And you're the God that answers human prayers. Thank you for that, Lord. You're the God with a really, really long fuse and a very short memory when it comes to our sins. You forgive, and we praise you for that. Because we're going to need it again tomorrow. Lord, you're the star creator. Some stars bigger than our whole solar system, and yet you wore sandals and walked around in Palestine and spoke Hebrew. It's almost too hard to comprehend, Lord. We praise you for that. We praise you for this great gospel story. You know how much we need it, God, and we know how much we need it too. We don't really like to say it so much, but God, in your presence, we have to admit that we are sinful people. We do wrong things. We like to do wrong things. In our new selves, Lord, when your spirit comes in, we don't want to do them. But in our old self, Lord, it still lingers, and we fight with it. And we pray by your mercy that you will strengthen us to choose your ways, because we know your ways are good. We know your ways always work. And we know the sins we do don't work. And sometimes we don't know why we still chase them, God. But unless you save us, we will not be saved. So forgive us our sins, Jesus, even again in this moment. We thank you that you're so willing to listen to prayers like these, that you're so patient. We thank you that you're a holy and perfect God who holds galaxies on your fingertips, and yet you made us to know you and even to live with you in eternity. We praise you for that too. We thank you, God, for everybody who's here today who's looking for your spirit, looking for your truth. We thank you for new neighbors and people that we've met that we didn't know before. We pray that we could bless them, that you would bless them through us. We thank you, Lord, for the lush beauty of the land around us. There's 8-foot walls of corn as far as we can see, where there was empty space a few months back. How you do that, Lord? How you do that? It's beautiful. We thank you for getaways, for time off, for vacations. We thank you, Jesus, for the Trinity picnic we could have last night, just enjoying your nature and playing games together and singing your praises and just enjoying each other. We thank you for that. We thank you, God, for the discovery class today that has a dozen or so people in it who want to know more about being Christian, being part of your church. Bless them, Lord. We're also a little concerned, Jesus, because we hear that Lisa Cooper's niece, great niece, Michaela, has leukemia, and she's just 17. How are they going to handle that, Lord? Oh, we pray for them. We pray that you will strengthen her parents and her. We pray that your Holy Spirit will help them see life from a perspective of eternity. That we pray that you would heal her, God, that you would take the leukemia out of her body. We know you can do that. You've done it before. I don't know what your plans are, God, but we pray for Michaela that you would bless her. We pray, Jesus, for floundering marriages where two people just can't seem to see eye to eye. And you know, God, that Satan loves to destroy us that way. We pray for your protection. We pray for your Holy Spirit to open up eyes, to see the truth, to admit, to want the right thing. God, we pray for our outdoor service. We pray for our interaction with Mayflower Mill in the near future. And we ask you, Jesus, help us just show your love in our community We believe you've called us to be passionately involved with our community. And so, God, show us ways and give us chances to do that. And kick us off our seats sometimes, Lord, when we're just too lazy to bother. Because we know your ways are always better. We pray these things in Jesus' name today. Let God's people say, amen. By the way, we were going to have an outdoor service next week over at Mayflower Mill Elementary School. Long story short, there's more hoops to jump through, so we can't do it next week. We have to do it sometime in August if the board gets all together and says yes. The principal has said yes, but the board hasn't said yes. So we hope to do that late August, maybe early September. But next week we're going to have outdoor service anyway. We're going to have it outdoor on our grass right here. So bring your lawn chairs, bring your sunshades, bring your beach umbrella, your blanket, whatever. Bring your neighbor. Maybe somebody would come to church with you who wouldn't come inside, but they'd like to sit outside and enjoy the beautiful weather. We'll try to face west so the sun's not in your eyes, only in mine. Okay? So that'll be next week. All right. And we're going to start studying today from God's Word, reading in Luke 4, and then we're going to jump to Galatians 6, okay? And if you're joining us for the first time today, we are in a series on what we call the art of neighboring, and we're looking at what the Bible has to say about how to be a good neighbor, how to love your neighbor as yourself, like Jesus commands us. And today we're in our sixth piece of that. I'm going to start in, Luke 4, verse 38. It's kind of an interesting story. Jesus left the synagogue, that's the church, the Jewish church, so to speak. A synagogue was 8 Jewish men or more who gathered together, okay? And went to the home of Simon. Now, Simon's mother-in-law was suffering from a high fever, and they asked Jesus to help her, so he bent over her, and he rebuked the fever, and it left her. She got up at once and began to wait on them. And when the sun was setting, the people brought to Jesus all who had various kinds of sickness. Laying his hands on each one, he healed them. Moreover, demons came out of many people, shouting, "You're the Son of God," and he rebuked them and would not allow them to speak because they knew he was the Christ. That's what we call a messianic secret. We'll have to talk about that some other time, why he did that. At daybreak, Jesus went out to a solitary place, and people were looking for him, and when they came to where he was, they tried to keep him from leaving. But he said, "I must preach the good news of the kingdom of God to the other towns also, because that is why I was sent." And he kept on preaching in the synagogues of Judea. All right, let's jump to Galatians 6. So that comes right after Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Galatians 6. And the first 5 verses. Here's what Paul is writing to the Galatian church, the Christians in the town of Galatia, Asia Minor, modern-day Turkey. And he says, "Brothers, if someone is caught in a sin, you who are spiritual should restore him gently. But watch yourself, for you also may be tempted. Carry each other's burdens, and in this way you fulfill the law of Christ." We looked at this just a little bit last week. "If anyone thinks he is something, when he is nothing, he deceives himself. Each one should test his own actions, and then he can take pride in himself without comparing himself to somebody else. For each one should carry his own load." All right, Galatians is the one I want to dig into with you, so I might want to keep that open on your lap. as I have said, we've been looking at being a good neighbor for the last 5 weeks or so. Still, it's likely that some of you may be hesitant to interact with a particular neighbor for some really good reasons. Two, some neighbors cause serious problems, and we know that. If the police are frequently showing up at the neighbor's door for domestic violence, for example, you have reason to be careful about how you be a neighbor. If your child has been abused or beaten up by the neighbor, you have reason to be wary about how you be a neighbor, how you fulfill God's command to love your neighbor. So what I want you to, us to see today is something that's also pointed out in the book, The Art of Neighboring, which you can get on the counter in the back if you like, is that good neighboring requires some good, healthy boundaries. I want to talk about those boundaries. We're talking here not about just property, but responsibilities and actions. When God tells us to be loving and to care about our neighbors, he's not saying that everyone must be our best friend and that we must ignore all dangers and offenses and we must give in to every request. He's not saying that. We'll have to draw some lines that we won't cross. Now, there's a saying, good fences make good neighbors. And I learned this morning even that Robert Frost includes that in a poem. Sometimes they don't, and sometimes they do. So I'm going to talk about the times that they do. Why would good fences make good neighbors? And here's the reason. Because good boundaries outline where our responsibilities stop and start and where the other person stop and start. Okay? So, for example, in their remarkable book called Boundaries, Cloud and Townsend tell a story of Bill. Bill's father went to a counselor for help for his son, who didn't go along to the counselor because he didn't have a problem. Dad had a problem. Okay? Well, Bill had struggled with drugs and the inability to stay in school or keep a job. And although his parents loved him very much, nothing they did seemed to help him. They always gave him everything he needed, plenty of money, even at school, so he didn't have to work, so that he had time for social things. And when he flunked out, they helped him find another school. And he kept up the same habits over and over. And the counselor shocked the father when he agreed that Bill did not have a problem. Dad did. He explained, and I quote, "Bill doesn't have a problem because you take all his problems. You pray, you pay, you fret, you worry, you plan, you bail him out. Those are his problems, but it looks like you're making them yours." And then the counselor said this, which I think is kind of funny. "Would you like for me to help you to help him have some problems?" Bill's dad is learning that relationships require boundaries. And for relationships to be healthy, people need to learn to carry their own responsibilities. And in the same way, being a good neighbor requires appropriate boundaries. And that's what we're going to talk about today. So setting up boundaries is simply making it clear what you're willing to do and not do in loving your neighbor. Now, here's something about people that is worth recognizing. Real people have real problems, just like us. Okay? They have real problems. And Jesus teaches us to love our neighbor like he loves, but when he does that, he's not telling us to take all their problems or all their responsibilities and bail them out of every consequence for their actions. God does not expect us to live another person's life for them. And Jesus himself, as we saw in Luke 4, sets limits on what he would do and who he would do it for. For example, in Luke 4, the people are quite excited, you remember, about his ability to heal their illnesses. And Luke says that they tried to keep him from leaving. Stick around, Jesus, because clearly you are a helpful resource, and we've got more problems. You know, we've got more cancer and more migraines and more macular degeneration back in town. So Jesus, stay with us and take care of us. And Jesus says, no, I've got other places. God sent me to go to other places too. I have other responsibilities. Is Jesus being selfish here? Is he uncaring? Do you remember the story of this Good Samaritan? I assume you do. Raise your hand if you remember the story. We studied it a couple weeks back, okay? All right, the Good Samaritan. So the Good Samaritan, the beaten up man, whose name we don't know, whose nationality we don't know, the one that got beaten up that the Samaritan took to the end. Here's the beaten up man now in the hotel, being cared for by the innkeeper. The Samaritan leaves extra money, says, take care of this guy. I got business to do. And the Samaritan is leaving, and what if the beaten-up guy sits up in bed and says, wait a minute, why are you leaving? Well, I've got business in Jericho. Well, don't you think you're being a little selfish here? I mean, like, I'm pretty bad off. And who's going to keep me company? And whatever happened to that whole deny yourself thing in the Bible? And you're just abandoning me in my time of need. You're never going to make it into one of Jesus' parables if you act like that. Well, I guess you're right. I could do more. I could postpone my entire trip just for you, and I could lose my business and go into financial ruin, not be able to help anyone ever again. How uncaring of me. Now, I realize I'm making the Good Samaritan seem very sarcastic. He probably was nicer than that. But I think that you see how nonsensical the scenario would be. And still, people do it all the time. They do it all the time. Relatives do it to each other. Neighbors do it to each other, too. God's Word teaches us that we have a responsibility. Here's the distinction that I think is really beautifully made in the book. We have responsibilities to our neighbors, but we are not responsible for our neighbors. Now, let's unpack that a little bit. We're responsible to them, but not for them. Being responsible to people is healthy. Being responsible for people is not. If you try to be responsible for your neighbor's decisions and actions, you may very well be very overwhelmed while also doing them a disservice. We're responsible to love our neighbors. We're responsible to pray for them. We're responsible to help them as we can, but we are not responsible for their happiness or for their success or for their choices or for their marriages and so on and so forth. When we try to be, we will likely enable them at the same time to just do more. Now, our text today points this out. This is kind of an interesting thing. So let's dig into Galatians chapter 6 for just a couple seconds so I can show you what I'm talking about. Now, at first reading, it seems a little confusing, doesn't it? The second verse says, carry each other's burdens. But by the time we get to the fifth verse, it says, bear your own load. Now, which one is it? How do we make sense of this? How do these concepts fit together? Well, first of all, the context will help us. Paul is talking about restoring or mending the troubles brought by a moral lapse in another person. You know, when we have moral lapses, it causes waves of trouble, not just for the person, but for all those around them. And some folks would take maybe the stoic, fatalistic approach, shrug their shoulders, I don't know, it's their choice, doesn't involve me. But as Christians, we know we're supposed to love our neighbors. We're supposed to pray for them. We're supposed to love our enemies even. Care. Try to restore the person. Not ignore their wrong or pass it off. Now, in that verse, it uses the term burden. It's a different term than used in verse 5. And burden refers to excessive or intense difficulty. Suffering of an illness or overburdensome taxation, for example. That's what this term would be used for. It is over and beyond ordinary demands of life. So Paul is instructing us here in verse 2 to help restore people in dire failures, to love them. And now in verse 5, Paul uses a different word. He says each one should carry their own load. In our English, that's what it says. And that word load refers to personal responsibilities, your ordinary task. It's not a weight such as a burden, which is a term for something overbearing. So here, Paul is saying that we each also have tasks and our own responsibilities that belong to us, and we must fulfill them. other people being responsible for something that belongs to us is unhealthy. And for everybody, really. So let's just say, let's say the neighbor has three kids who are constantly playing in the street. And it's a busy street. Let's say that the parents are very frequently spending their time in the pool in the backyard, which is fenced in and closed off. And they are oblivious to regular imminent danger. And let's just say that you see this very clearly. Now, it's certainly appropriate to raise a warning with the kids or with the parents because you care. But let's just say it happens regularly, and the parents are fully aware that their kids often play in the street, and they're not worried about it. Now, you are free to stand guard every time their kids go and play in the street. I mean, you may do that if you want to. But if you didn't, and one of the parents came over to you after their child got hit by a car and complained that you weren't watching their kid, that would certainly be inappropriate, wouldn't it? That would not make sense. Because the responsibility is theirs. Now, I'm sure that none of you do this, but some parents do their kids' homework. Flat out give them the answers to get it done because it's almost bedtime, you know. You might tell yourself you're being compassionate, but in reality, we're hurting our child's hope to learn, right? Well, maybe not their hope to learn, their responsibility to learn. They might not hope to do it. When we get close enough to our neighbors to share their pains, which we talked about last week, degree of relationship, you know, getting to the depth where we actually share their joys and their difficulties. When we get close enough to our neighbors to share their pains, the deeper level, it may mean that we are also tempted to cross boundaries that we should not. Suppose a neighbor has a domestic disturbance, and the wife comes over and knocks on your door, you know, after sundown with her pillow in hand and says, "Can I sleep here for the night?" Now, that may be appropriate or legitimate. But if she comes over every night for months asking to stay by you for the night, and you really care about your neighbor, it might be more loving for you to say, "I'm sorry, you can't keep sleeping here. You and your husband need to face your disagreement and work it out." Or let's suppose your son is smoking weed at his friend's house, which is illegal in Indiana. And being a loving neighbor to the friend's family might mean that you need to talk to the boys and to the other family and draw your boundaries. "I'm sorry, but if I don't want to cause trouble, you keep giving my kid drugs, I'm going to turn everybody in. Because there are lines that, you know, I'm not going to cross. And you got to be responsible." Well, there's just some examples of trying to set clear boundaries as we love our neighbors. And of course, you know, much more insignificant illustrations you can think of yourself as well. I want to think of a couple misconceptions about doing this. Okay, some people think different things. And Cloud and Townsend in their book, Boundaries, which if you have never read it, you should read it. It's really excellent. List just a couple. I'm going to throw them at you real quick. One misconception is it's cruel to not help. No, that's not so true. A handout isn't the same thing as a helping hand. And bailing someone out could well make someone's life worse. Remember Bill at the beginning of our study together? Here's a verse from Proverbs. Let's read it out loud. Ready? This is going to maybe shock some people. I don't know. "Do not withhold discipline from a child." Read with me. "If you punish him with the rod, he will not die, punish him with the rod and save his soul from death. I don't know about you, but I got punished with the rod plenty when I was a kid. My mom used one of those long wooden, never mind. I didn't die. That's a misconception. Okay, here, second misconception. Setting limits is selfish. That's a misconception too. Okay, that's just not true. Is it really selfish to tell your child that she may not play with knives? That's not selfish. Was Jesus selfish for not healing everyone in the town in our passage in Luke 4? Was Paul selfish when he wrote to the Christians in the city of Thessalonica this following verse, which we are now going to read out loud? This is in the Bible already. Let's read it out loud, everyone. For even when we were with you, we gave you this rule: if a man will not work, he shall not eat. You're responsible. Wow. That's a misconception. Another misconception: setting boundaries will cost me more in the long run. If I just let the kid do what he wants, it's a lot easier. No, it's not. Set the boundaries. We had one son who, when he was young, if we said, ah, he would stop. We had another son, we have four sons, as you know. We had another son who, if we said, ah, he would go. You better get that spanking spoon ready, because I'm a-going. No, it costs us more in the long run. The lack of boundaries, which we also call laws, costs us the most. All right, another misconception. Setting boundaries means that I'm mad or angry. No, it doesn't. You can be firm and authoritarian kindly without anger. Making a good rule is, in fact, an act of love, right? Here's what the Bible says, Proverbs 3. My son, don't despise the Lord's discipline. Don't resent his rebuke, because the Lord disciplines those he loves. As a father, the son he delights in. If you delight in your child, it means you will discipline your child. The Bible says also, if you don't discipline him, you're not delighting in him. And here's one from Revelation we can read together. Ready? God is talking, those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. And if anyone hears my voice and opens a door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. Wow. That's love. Repent. Let me show you the way. Come and eat with me. We're going to do that in just a minute. I'd like to make a shift here as we conclude and before we go to the Lord's Supper time, because there's a deep spiritual principle at play here in our text. Paul is referring to eternal realities. Did you notice that? It's just not physical neighborly circumstances, but there's eternal realities. Take a look at verse 7 and 8 in our text. We didn't read this earlier, okay? Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. Okay, consequences come with what we do. The one who sows to please his sinful nature, from that nature will reap destruction. It's the way it goes. The one who sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Now, Paul has jumped right into spiritual realities here. Eternal life. It's a clear term, a clear theme in Scripture. For example, Hebrews, Hosea 10 says this: sow for yourselves righteousness, reap the fruit of unfailing love. Break up your unplowed ground. It's time to seek the Lord until he comes and showers righteousness. But you planted wickedness, so you've reaped evil, and you've eaten the fruit of deception. It's a scriptural theme. Proverbs 22, he who sows wickedness reaps trouble. What is all this saying? Really, there are consequences for how we live on earth, and those consequences carry into eternity. There are eternal consequences, and we are responsible for our own eternal consequences. Heaven has set some good boundaries, and mankind, and you and I know it, we have jumped the fence many times. And it means some important things. It means that I'm not going to get your consequences, and you're not going to get my consequences, and you're not going to get dad's consequences or mom's consequences or grandpa's consequences or grandma's consequences. They might be good, upstanding, moral people, but you're going to get your consequences, and I'm going to get mine. We need to face the responsibility that we carry for our own lives. So, in the end, health and life come from realizing what we're actually responsible for. And the Bible tells us that we are responsible for the state of our soul, our sinfulness. Now, the good news is, and what this table is all about, is that Jesus' death paid for our consequences. No joke. He paid for our consequences, what we are responsible for. Whoa. But we are still responsible to accept it and to believe in him and to ask him to apply it to us. We each need to do that ourselves and receive the forgiveness of Christ for ourselves. So the good news is you can. You can do it right now. So let's pray. And you can just pray in your own heart right after me if you mean the words that I'll pray. Lord Jesus, I realize that I'm responsible for my own soul and my own behavior. And I also realize, God, that I cannot pay for it because I don't have enough power or strength or goodness to do so. But God, I understand from your word that you sent your son to take my responsibilities and pay for my sins. And that blows my mind, God, and I thank you for that. And I ask you to apply it to me. I confess that I need your forgiveness. And I pray that you will be my God and my Lord, and that you will not let go of me, and that you will take me through all the little fights and things I do on the way to being your child in your house eating with you someday. And I'm depending on you, Lord, and not myself. And I pray this in Jesus' name. God's people say, amen. I'm going to have to ask the praise team to come up, and we're going to had the elders come and pass out the Lord's Supper. So you can stay sitting while we sing this song. It's a song of praise and thanks to God. And sing along with it. Sing if you want to. If you want to just meditate, you can do that. I'm going to make I'll make the announcements later because I just don't want to break the moment. Okay, so elders, would you please come forward and take the elements, and the praise team will lead us into this song, and then in a moment, do not eat the elements until the song is done and I bring us to it, okay? Because we're going to read us a text together.
Thank you.
for salvation. Thank you for unending grace. Thank you for your hope. Thank you for this life you give.
Elements, and carefully open the top layer there and take out the bread first. And then go ahead and open the wine. And I'm going to read, before we take the elements, this great passage from John chapter 3, which I'm sure you'll recognize. It says, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert. This is a story from the Old Testament in the book of Numbers, where there were snakes that were infecting the tribes and so forth, and because of their rebellion. And God told Moses to make a bronze snake and hold it up on a cross in the middle of the camp. And anybody who got bitten, if they would look to the cross, they would not die. If they did not look to the cross, they would die. That's exactly what happened. And so as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, Jesus says, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned. Did you hear that? Whoever believes in him is not condemned. So if you're sitting in this room today or watching with us on the stream, if you believe in Jesus, you are not condemned. The Bible says you have crossed over from death into life. That's John chapter 5. But whoever does not believe stands condemned already because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. So we're not sitting in a neutral situation. We're sitting in the negative situation. We need the solution. This is the verdict, says verse 19. Light has come into the world, but men love the darkness instead of the light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates light, will not come to light for fear his deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, and that's what we call repentance. I'm going to walk into the light. I'm going to let the light shine on the fact that I do not have it all together. I never will without the grace of God. Whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that by it it may be plainly seen that what he has done has been done through God. It is God who saves. It is God who brings us in. So my friends, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. And take the bread, which represents his body, and the little cup of juice, which represents the blood that poured out of his body on a cross 2,000 some years ago. Eat it and drink it and remember and believe it. Let's pray. We are amazed, Jesus, at who you are. And yes, God, we're banking it all on you and your goodness because you gave it all for us. Send us into your world, God, to show that love to another person, to show you to that another person. In Jesus' name, amen. Why don't you stand? Let's praise God in song.
Out to the world to make you known.
the darkest place, in the name of Jesus, I want to be your hands and feet. I want to be your voice every time I speak. I want to run to the ones in need, in the name of Jesus. I want to give my life away, all for your kingdom's sake. Shine a light in the darkest place, in the name of Jesus.
And how God's people said, amen. I'm just going to give a couple announcements before I send you out. Trinity VBS, Trinity is going to do a VBS, and they're looking for some canopies and so forth to use. So if you have one you want to loan, please bring it to the church sometime this week. And remember that next week we're going to have an outdoor service on our own lawn. So invite your friends, invite your neighbors. Go in peace, love and serve God. May his glory reign over all of us as we sang at the very first song. Amen. Join us for some coffee and some refreshments out in the back.
Children of generosity.